He's ruined my life. And he's ruined the life of Maureen and Ray.
There had been a murder. It was a suspected case of road rage. There was a survivor, a girlfriend. It was a national story from the first moment.
She's my daughter and I love her.
I absolutely hate her. I hated her before, I hate her more now.
She was a tart.
She will present a view of Tracy that she wants to present. And when do you ever know the real Tracy?
And she actually turned round and told me and my family, if she couldn't have Lee, nobody would.
Please just come forward. And if anybody else can remember seeing us, can remember seeing the car following us, or can remember anything about this, please just come forward, because every little thing could help.
Hi, my name's Tracy Andrews. I'm 25 years old and a barmaid. I live in Elfchurch, just outside Birmingham.
Hi, I'm Lee Harvey, 23 years old, and I'm a bus driver from Kings Norton in Birmingham.
I like dancing, going out with friends and having a good time.
I like martial arts, cars and the blues, Birmingham City FC.
A perfect man. Tall, dark, good sense of humour, sexy. Oh yeah, he's got to be sexy.
Perfect woman. Pamela Anderson.
He was gorgeous, good looking, but very much a family man.
She was just a nice girl, very glamorous. Probably a lot of young people or young girls envied her.
Right. Know you, don't I?
Oh yeah, I think so.
Seen you in the Swan.
You're with your girlfriend?
Ex-girlfriend. Buy you a drink?
We met Tracy at a nightclub. Basically, they danced, had a drink and chatted.
She was a bit of a showstopper. She walked into a club and, you know, she made herself look good, and it had the desired effect.
He was really keen on her. He was keen on her from the day he met her. I think she was the same with him. I think it was all like love at first sight, if you believe in that sort of, you know, they both was really attracted to each other.
I know Lee said it was the best sex he's ever had. I think he had one or two.
She'd met somebody named Lee and what he was like and all this lot. Well, I was always the same as I've always been, you know. Well, okay, fine, you know, well, we'll meet him one day.
I don't know what made this girl so special in Lee's eyes, but then I don't choose my son's girlfriends for him, it's for him to choose.
Jesus Christ, I love you.
What'd you say?
I still love you, Trace.
Don't say things like that unless you mean them, Lee. You don't joke about things like that.
I'm not messing about, Trace. I love you.
He said that he loved her, and that but she got a temper.
She absolutely loved him to bits. Yeah, she did love him, yeah.
She just said she'd met this guy, and she was very happy because obviously Lee had a daughter, and she had a daughter. Now her daughter had got a sister, really, and she was just happy.
Getting on all right, innit?
Yeah. It's nice for her to have someone to play with. Never know what to do with her come the weekend. I mean, you can take her uptown, but that costs money, doesn't it? Andy gives us a few quid, but it's never enough.
He's generous, though, isn't he?
Andy? Who's her dad? Do the same for yours.
Yeah.
Oh, look at them. They could be sisters.
It's weird, isn't it?
What?
In a good way, like. Them two and us two out doing stuff.
Yeah.
It's nice.
Anybody looking to think we're a proper family?
Stranger things have happened. Be careful, love.
Sarah shouldn't worry about her. Hard as nails, she is.
What, like a mum?
You cheeky bastard. It's not easy, you know.
I know. You're a good mum, Trace.
You're quite the family man, aren't you, Lee Harvey? What would the lads say?
Nothing. She's my daughter. Besides, she's the only one that laughs at my jokes.
Go on. Whee!
They were so in love, but they couldn't believe that each other could stay with each other. And I could see there was going to be a bit of a problem.
She seemed to go for long-term relationships, but previous partners also reported the volatile nature, that she could be easily provoked, and that her anger was intense. The picture that emerged was that Tracy and Lee had a very volatile relationship. There were loads of rows.
What the hell do you think you're playing at?
What?
She's all over you.
She what? Who is?
That tart. You're meant to be here with me.
I am with you.
Careful if I catch you looking at her again.
You what? You don't own me, Tracy.
You're taking the piss, Lee. I've seen you looking her up and down.
Piss off.
Look, I'm here with all my mates. You're making me look all right, Pratt. When you're out with me, you're with me, okay?
No, not okay. See you later.
There was some sort of obsession there. It wasn't a healthy, normal relationship.
I think when you get a volatile emotional mix, you've just got to sit back and say anything can happen.
I think I'd say they were both obsessed in some sort of way.
Always there's a possibility that it's going to end in violence.
Relationship was getting worse in my eyes than ever. But I had quite a few rows.
They've both obviously been in previous relationships. They've both got a daughter and they were both jealous of the ex-partner.
Hello. Oh, yeah, hello. No, it's all right. Oh, is that okay? Oh, good. She had a great time last week. Can stop going on about it. Yeah. Yeah. Look, can I call you back later? Yeah. All right, try.
What was happening as if I didn't know?
Oh, Andy wanted to know if I could collect the little one on Thursday.
But that's not all he wanted.
What did you say? He's her dad. I've got to stay in touch for her sake. I can't just pretend he doesn't exist, you know. Look, it's no different to you and your ex. You're jealous, aren't you?
No.
You are, aren't you?
No, it's just he's around all the time. You and him doing stuff. It's like you're still together or something.
Oh, for Christ's sake, Lee. I told you about the three of us right from the start.
Yeah, right.
Well, where are you going now?
So I go for a group with Gary.
When? I thought we were having a night in.
Well, now I'm going out, you know. I'll stay at my mum's.
Don't just walk out of here, Lee.
Just get off of me.
I don't think you can come back later either. I'll piss off then, you bastard. Sorry.
There was too much passion between the pair of them. They both love one another too much, and they both never trusted each other at all. So there was arguments all the time.
Their relationship was on, it was off. Every other weekend he'd come back home and like he'd move his stuff back into mine. And then like six weeks later he'd move back with her. And then I'd say, why did you go back? And he'd say, I love her, Mum.
The one thing that he did turn around and say was the one night they'd split up and he came round to mine and we were chatting. And he says, the worst thing, he says, I absolutely couldn't stand another bloke to have sex with her. He couldn't bear that thought.
Oh, you've got a nerve.
Trace, just give me a minute, will you?
Working.
We need to talk.
Oh, I thought you'd rather talk to your mum, or your sister, or Gary. In fact, anybody rather than me. 260, please.
Trace, look. I love you.
If you love somebody, you don't just walk out on them and not check to see if they're all right. I haven't heard from you all week.
No, I was out of order. Trace!
What?
I'm sorry. I just get a bit jealous sometimes.
Yeah, well, maybe we should just call it a day.
No. Look, I miss you. Let me come round after work.
No, I'm going out.
No, you're not.
I couldn't really understand. He must have been besotted by Tracer, because he obviously wanted more and more and more. He wanted to be with her. I don't think he could ever change her. And I don't know whether he was coming to the terms of just putting up with it. Perhaps he thought that by getting engaged, it might change her, might give her more security, get married, might settle her down.
Lee, what are you doing? Lee? You bloody nutter.
Trace, I've been doing a lot of thinking, and I think that all the rows and us two being jealous and stuff, it's because we're all up in the air, we don't know where we stand, and I want to put that right.
Don't, Lee.
Trace.
Lee, if you're pissing about.
I'm not messing about. I've never been more serious in my life. Trace, I want you to marry me.
Got the money?
Never mind all that. I love you, Tracy. And I want you to be my wife.
You're mad, Lee Harvey.
Probably. Well, Tracy Andrews. Is that a yes?
I didn't ever think it was going to lead to marriage. It was just a passing whim.
I knew it wouldn't work because I knew what they were like.
My daughter was getting engaged and we had got a family gathering. Tracy Andrews came to this barbecue that we had and my daughter had said that she was going to get engaged. Tracy Andrews just ran into my living room and cried and like performed and like went into sort of a rage.
We talk about getting married, being the first, planning, organising, and then she comes right out with it in front of the whole family. Oh, me and Steve, we just couldn't wait. Stupid Kim.
Just calm down, will ya? So what if Michelle's getting married? What do you care?
Because nobody is going to give a toss about us now she's getting married, are they?
Tracy, darling.
Oh, I better never put her up to it. Your mother, that's who. Oh, it all makes sense, don't it? Just get in there first. Put her in her place. I'm right, aren't I? Aren't I?
No! Mum wouldn't say nothing. And even if she did, it'd only be to just...
What, to spoil my life? To ruin everything? Look, Lee, for the first time in my life, I had something to look forward to. And now, that nasty... That selfish little bitch!
You've got to stop this, Tracy,
stop.
I'm telling you.
I tell you what, love, I haven't even frigging started.
Enough! I've had enough!
Get off me! Don't touch me! Don't come near me like that again!
She gave an ultimatum. She just turned around and said, like, you're not going to the wedding. If you go to the wedding, we're through.
Well, Saint Michelle's wedding has put me right in the middle between Tracy and my family. It's a bloody nightmare, I tell you.
Yeah, I hate her for what she did. There's no way I was letting go to that wedding.
I just never know where I am. I mean, one minute we're arguing, next minute we're in each other's arms. Can't live with each other.
Can't live without each other.
Temper? You're joking, aren't you? When she goes, it's like World War III, mate.
Yeah, I know I get jealous, but so does he. We're both as bad as each other.
Finish with her? Nah. I couldn't imagine another bloke touching her.
I couldn't live without him.
We're engaged, I mean, how much closer can you get?
I'm pregnant.
Pregnant?
Yeah. Labour. Are you angry?
I'm bloody furious.
All she wanted was a happy life and have a family and be a happy family woman.
When they first told us, I was a bit, oh gosh, like, you know, no, that's it, they are an item. Doesn't matter what happens, there's going to be a kid out of all this at the end of the day. I was very upset to hear that she'd had a miscarriage. She told us she fell down some steps in Redditch when she was shopping and she lost the baby, and Lee was absolutely devastated.
My mum and myself had both gone over to be with her, and we were really upset.
Later in the relationship, towards the end of the relationship, they'd had a row and it came out that she'd actually got rid of the baby. She'd had an abortion.
It's not the point, is it?
It is the frigging point.
She had aborted the child because she felt that she was going to ruin her life.
Oh, the arguments became physical because I witnessed quite a few of them.
You deserve it!
Don't come near me! Just leave me alone!
They had a fight and there's bruising all up her arm, bruising all up this arm. I can quite well imagine he had bruising as well. So obviously, they were both as bad as one another.
There had been assaults previously, one upon the other. Neither was sort of blameless as far as it went. And the police, they'd been called to domestic disputes there.
Open the door, please, the police.
What?
Hello, love. Good if you called. I'm
pissed off.
Check you're all right. Charlie. Open the door, please.
Come on then, right, tell them what you said. On. What was it? You were going to kill me, weren't you?
Yeah, well, you killed the baby, didn't you, eh?
Oh, yeah, that's right, Lee, that's right. Get off!
All right.
Did you see that?
Shut up. What's your name?
Lee. Lee Harvey.
All right, well, maybe Mrs. Harvey and you can take me inside and we can talk about this calmly.
She's not Mrs. Harvey. She never will be either.
Get off, Lee. Don't touch me, Lee Harvey. What did you just say? What did you say to me, Lee?
I'd seen Tracy before I knew that she was going out with Leigh, in other bars and nightclubs.
Yeah, well, you know, I've been really busy. You know, girls, time just flies.
Well, it's nice to see you, even if you are engaged and haven't told me. Is she here?
Yeah, somewhere.
Leigh, I've heard. Well, you know, things have been a bit on-off. It's been all right.
She's a bit of a rough patch.
He said that she was going barmy because he'd gone to Baker's and she told him he wasn't supposed to be. Not that he wasn't supposed to be going out, but shouldn't be in Baker's because it was her night in there.
Vicky, I don't really... Oh, I was looking around for you.
Yeah, I bet you were.
I was, actually. Tracy, this is...
When you bite into an apple, you don't actually take the apple out, but you pull your teeth out and you've got the actual teeth mark in the apple. It was like that.
He's walked into my shop and like he's got scratches all on his face and he's got a bite mark on his neck. He looks as if he's been attacked by a dog.
I just said, please, please leave her. She's no good for you. She's a tart.
And I said, you've got a young daughter here, and you've got to be responsible for her, and you've got to be here for her, and you shouldn't put yourself in this situation. And the best thing you can do is get rid of her.
He was like being torn between what he should do and what he was going to do. It was just sad, really. I think it was, he was besotted by her. There was just something in him that made him stay with her, even though I think deep down he knew that he shouldn't.
Come round to get your stuff.
Yeah. Try.
I'm sorry, I never meant to lose my thing.
We can't go on like this, Trace. It's not right.
I know. Come back, Lee. Come home.
Don't, Trace.
Look, it'll be better, I promise. No more rows. A new start, yeah?
It's just every time we try again, we're at each other's throats. Fighting all the time. And about what? Me talking to another girl? We're only talking, for Christ's sake.
Oh, sorry, Lee, I just get a bit jealous sometimes.
You can't behave like that, Trace, you just can't.
I know.
And you get so angry. You frighten me, Tracy. You really do. Do I make you that unhappy? Do I, Trace?
No, Lee, of course you don't know.
Then what are we going to do then, eh? What are we going to do? I don't want this.
Well, then don't. I love you, Lee. I love you.
I said he can't come back, Tracy. He can not come back because you don't get on. So she took him back. And she took him back, and this is what happened.
Yeah, she reckons it might have to go back again, which would be a third time. What's going on?
It's just getting light. Come on, I'll help you off.
What, aren't you going to stop and buy?
Yes, I'll give him a ring next week. I'm away for the weekend, so I have to wait till then.
Thank you, Dave.
Thanks for dinner.
Take care. Mm-hmm. See you later.
Return the compliment.
Bye.
Cheers.
Bye.
Confirmed reports are coming in of a road rage attack in the Old Church area of Birmingham. It's believed a man has been murdered at the scene.
Can you tell me what happened?
Told him not to get out of the car.
Hey.
Tracy Andrews was all we had. We had to capitalise on everything that Tracy could actually tell us.
Can I go to the Luna?
Of course, I'll take you.
They told me that the witness to the murder would be brought from the hospital, and I was expected then to see her and find out what had gone on, and that was Tracy Andrews.
Well, we were on our way back from the pub, the Marlbrook in Bromsgrove. That was, I don't know, about 10 o'clock. We just turned into School Lane, which goes from Bromsgrove back towards my house. Suddenly there was this honk on the horn from the car behind us.
Piss off, you tosser!
Careful, Lee!
It's not me, is it?
Is it one of your mates?
Then I realised that the car behind us was following us, and Lee was in a right cop with him, you know, speeding up and deliberately slowing down. We got into Cooper's Hill, and Lee said...
Right, I've had enough of this.
The driver got out.
Lee! What are you doing?
He was young, 18 to 19, with dark, short hair, and I shouted to Lee,
God's sake, Lee!
Get back in the car! Then the passenger got out of the car. He was older, fatter, and he had big, staring eyes. He was calling Lee, Paggy bastard. And then he started hitting Lee in the face. I got out of the car, and he smacked me in the face. I heard the driver shout,
come on, kids, leave it!
The fat man then got back in the car and they drove off.
Lee! Lee! Are you alright, bud?
I was checking for Lee's pulse, but I couldn't find it and I couldn't hear it breathing.
Lee! Lee! Lee, speak to me! Mum!
I didn't have to draw a tremendous amount of detail from her because she seemed to know what had happened, how it had happened, where it had happened.
It wasn't a story that immediately sort of jumped out as saying, well, this couldn't have happened. I mean, everything said, there's a likelihood that this could have happened.
I was in bed asleep. There was a knock on the door. They asked us if we was Mr. and Mrs. Harvey. We got a son called Lee. There'd been an accident, they'd said, but it had been some sort of road rage. And somebody had stabbed my son, and he was dead.
I just knew that she'd done it. I just knew. My mum sort of calmed me down and was saying, look, you know, she's been attacked as well, and she hasn't done it.
The attack happened on a country lane near Old Church in Worcestershire. Lee Harvey died from multiple stab wounds as his girlfriend, a passenger, tried to comfort him. The unemployed bus driver was murdered after a road rage confrontation.
Yes, you could call it road rage. Obviously, to us, it's murder.
All she kept saying at the hospital was, please, please tell me where Lee is. Is he all right? Where is Lee? Is he all right? How is Lee? Is he all right? That's all she kept saying.
West Mercia police are today holding a press conference to appeal for witnesses to a suspected road rage murder.
Why I put that press conference out in the manner I did was to get witnesses who'd seen either Lee and Tracy's car that night and as possibly could have been the black car in association with it.
The police were telling us that Tracy Andrews was going to appear in person, and also Lee's parents. So it was a big story, and we knew that the survivor and the main witness was going to be there telling us what happened.
They asked us if we'd like to sit with her, because at first it was just going to be Tracy Andrews, and then they said, would you like to go in? We didn't really want to, but like we felt if we could bring any sort of witnesses forward, it was a way of doing it.
Once the cameras started rolling, she pretty much got into it and seemed to have a hell of a lot to say, you know, for somebody who was supposed to be very upset and in shock.
The driver walked off. Nothing to do with the driver.
And I held her hand because I wanted to believe her.
I asked the question, So Tracy Unley left the pub at about 10:30. And she said no.
About what time did you leave the pub?
Well, we left about 10 to 10, something like that, I'd say.
Yes.
I didn't really look at my watch, I don't really know what time I left.
That's 10 to 10, not 10 to 11?
No, about 10 to 10.
Okay. The account she gave to us did not correspond at all with what we'd been given and led to believe by the police.
There was an impact, yeah, and there was a little sort of moment. And I think I did sort of step in after a while and sort of say...
We're perhaps getting into a bit too much detail that we don't actually want to go into quite at the moment.
Either the police had misled us, or the police had been misled.
I fell to the floor, I can't remember if I was knocked out for a bit or what, I don't know.
How can you sit and hold the hand of the mother of the guy that you've just murdered?
I wanted to believe that Lee had died by some, you know, somebody else had killed him, not by the hands of his lover.
She deserved an Oscar for her performance on that appeal.
Everybody always says, oh, yeah, well, you know, the police must have known this, must have known the other. No, I mean, there was no immediate thing saying, this has got to have been done by Tracy at all. I got what I hoped to get. I got it slightly a different way round to what I thought may first come round, but I got the sighting of Lee and Tracy's vehicle that there was to get.
Tracy went upstairs to have a sleep because she hadn't slept for days and days and days, and I said, let her go and have a sleep.
I went mid-morning. Her family were a little bit concerned that she'd been over to her flat on her own, which was only a short walk from the family home, and she then got a little bit groggy and didn't want anything to do with them, had shut herself away in one of the rooms, you know.
We picked her bag up. In her bag, it was just a note of her daughter saying, I'm so sorry, I can't be here no more. I want to be with Lee. So suddenly I said, oh my God.
Are you all right in there?
I said, get an ambulance, you know, get an ambulance here now. Ring them up, tell them, you know, it's an overdose.
Suspected overdose. Tracy, come on, darling, speak to me.
They reckon she died twice in the ambulance. She meant, really meant to do what she did.
So she was already in hospital, starting to recover from her overdose during the Wednesday when we obtained the evidence that changed the story.
Well, Tracy's version was that
Tracy and Lee are travelling from that direction down there. As they turn into this junction to travel to Cooper's Hill up this way, both cars are together. The alleged Black Sierra is right behind them and the chase is still on. Simon Baker and Elaine Carruthers are travelling down this way. They see the lights of a vehicle travelling from this direction. One vehicle only. That car passes before their lights down here, and Simon Baker is able to tell that that's a Ford Escort of the XR3i type. It seems to follow that that time they're having such a disagreement between each other that actually Lee's overshot the junction. As he stops at the line to clear his road this way, Simon Baker notices that this white vehicle has actually stopped on this near side of the road, and as he starts to pull away, look in his mirror, he sees the vehicle starting to reverse back towards this junction. And obviously from then on, Lee took this road, which is his direct road home, through Cooper's Hill. No Black Sierra vehicle, then the story that Tracy was giving could not be true in what she was saying. The only car that they saw was Lee and Tracy's Ford Escort.
And that was absolutely crucial evidence. It destroyed the whole road rage, pursuing vehicle, screaming down country lanes, being overtaken on the brow of Cooper's Hill. That was devastating evidence.
When it turned on that, it turned the investigation towards looking at Tracy, and therefore I made the decision that she would be arrested on the Saturday morning.
Tracy Andrews, I'm arresting you in connection with the murder of Lee Harvey. You do not have to say anything, but it may harm your defence if you mention...
I just broke down and cried. I wanted the story to be the road rage. I didn't want it to be that she killed him.
I was glad that, you know, she'd been arrested. But at the same time, he still can't come to terms with it.
Well, I was just... can you be? I shouldn't have. I couldn't believe it.
My client was arrested 3 minutes ago, and she is now being taken to Redditch Police Station. She has been arrested on suspicion of the murder.
A few days later, she was given the medical all clear, and we went and took her from the hospital back to the police station, where she was interviewed at length. And this time she was, you know, asked about the discrepancies, and the witness evidence was put to her.
They were asking questions and all this lot, and she said, OK, right, I want to tell you something now.
And it was at that point I really did think she was going to confess. She went very quiet, and there was a sort of pregnant pause in the interview, and I thought, yeah, she's going. And she asked to speak to a solicitor. We came out of the interview and I thought, she's going to tell us now what really happened. And they had something like a 45-minute consultation. When we went back in, she pretty much said, I've got nothing further to say, I've got nothing else to tell you.
She has been interviewed at length by the police, and she has vehemently denied any involvement in the murder of her fiancé. And she stands by that total and absolute denial.
Tracy chose an unusually flamboyant solicitor who decided to lift reporting restrictions at the first magistrate's court appearance. That meant that every detail of that court case could then be repeated.
It was what you would call a proactive defence, and they went out with their own press conferences, they went out to publish information and to seek their own witnesses independent of ourselves.
Free on bail and fighting to clear her name, Tracy Andrews today continued to protest she's innocent of murder.
The extraordinary moment here was that the police were there at a defence press conference.
Detectives leading the murder inquiry turned up unexpectedly and without invitation.
I wouldn't say so much as guests as probably uninvited guests. Yeah, we made the decision to go to this.
In 30 years, I suppose now, in journalism, I've never been to a defence press conference.
Today, her lawyer took the extraordinary step of issuing a photo-fit picture of the man she claims was the real killer.
Whoever committed that vile, wicked act is still at large.
She did an e-fit that looked remarkably like I'd looked on the night that I first met her.
So we had this situation where the defence had published the e-fit, but we were receiving nominations as to who that possibly was.
In fact, people were saying to me, you know, it's you, you know, the e-fit's you. My mother-in-law rang my wife and said, there's a photograph of our Brian in the paper, very fat-faced, short hair, and it was very much like me.
Tracy Andrews is alleged to have stabbed her boyfriend more than 30 times. Today at Birmingham Crown Court, she denied murdering him.
I think that she actually intended to kill him.
I was by no means sure, before the trial started, that she would be found guilty.
She thought she could put it off. She's so naive that she thought she could put it off.
I think that she thought she was somebody special, and she was nothing but a calculating murderer.
You think you can just dump me then, do you, Lee Harvey? Hey? Turn your back on me!
Tracy Andrews ran the gauntlet of press and television cameras today when she arrived at Birmingham Crown Court for the 10th day of her trial for the murder of her fiancé, Lee Harvey.
I think we all remember looking from the windows at Birmingham Crown Court and seeing the sort of like the entourage arrive, you know, and immediately everybody ran down the steps, out came the cameras, and I thought, how many shots of this girl do you want?
It was horrible. One of the worst times of my life, because you sit there and you listen to the evidence.
The prosecution case was geared to taking each element of what on the evidence we believe to be a deceit and seeking to expose it for what it was.
Police today set out the evidence to support their account of what they believe took place on the night of Lee Harvey's murder.
I'm sure they were arguing. I'm sure there was one dickens of a row going on in that car at some stage.
I knew it! Tonight, would you fancy a drink? I thought you were going to make it all right, but it's not, is it? Oh, go on. Say it. You can't, can you? Because you're gutless.
Shut up, Trace. Don't say it anymore. It's over.
It will never, ever be over. Tell me you don't love me.
Don't say any more of this.
tell me! You don't love me!
She was ready for something physically taking place between them. Tracy and Lee are coming down this way, over the top of Cooper's Hill. We believe that actually Tracy tried to leave the vehicle right outside Keeper's Cottage. It obviously moved quickly from being just perhaps a verbal dispute to some sort of physical assault between them.
Tracy, get back in the car!
I'll sod you then.
Oh, you think you can just dump me then, do you, Lee Harvey? Hey, turn your back on me!
Lee Harvey had sustained many, many injuries, something in the region of 30-odd, maybe 40. And a large number of those had been to the neck. She could not explain the injuries that had been sustained to his back. And the reality of that was that Lee Harvey had been stabbed whilst he was retreating. She was drenched in Lee Harvey's blood, particularly on her left side, particularly in her hair, particularly on her upper garments. She had been within range of that fountain spraying of arterial blood. Her account did not allow for that. She maintained she'd only gone over to Lee Harvey at a time after he was already lying on the floor.
20 feet in front of the vehicle in what used to be a ditch up there is a black woolen hat, which we obviously assume has come from the assailant vehicle.
She admitted that the hat had been in her pocket in the car on the fateful night. The only inference available to a jury was that she had deliberately taken that hat from her pocket, put it there in that place to support her account of the second car.
At about 10:50 thereabouts on the Sunday night, the witness Richard Main was leaving the house behind his keeper's cottage to go to his car. The automatic lights came on, and that's when he heard Tracy calling for help.
There is a time lapse between the time when undoubtedly Lee Harvey was either dead or dying and Mr. Main came face to face with the defendant. There was a minimum of about 7 minutes after Lee Harvey had sustained his fatal injuries, during which there was no attempt by the defendant to summon any help from the house.
We made a very extensive search of this area for the weapon. We couldn't assume that it had gone with the alleged assailant. We had to be sure that we made our best effort to find it.
The strongest point for the defence was the absence of a murder weapon. The reality, as the evidence eventually showed, was that she had secreted it about herself. She must have slipped it inside one of her boots. It must have been in there when she was taken to hospital. It must have been in there while she was in the hospital. And then, the evidence was, she kept slipping away for long periods of time to one of the lavatories nearby within the hospital.
Can I go to the loo now?
Of course, I'll take you.
She had put the knife closed within the snakeskin boot at the scene. And then spirited away through the hospital lavatory system. Within her boot was found, in blood, a stain which was the replica in its shape, dimension and size of a Swiss Army knife.
A packed courtroom gathered this morning as Tracy Andrews took the witness stand to give her account of what happened on the night of her fiancé Lee Harvey's murder.
Tracy's QC began to take her through her story.
I just looked at her and I thought, how cold and how could she stand there and lie? And the lies were just coming out so easily.
David Krigman, prosecuting QC, stood up to cross-examine. And slowly but surely, piece by piece, molecule by molecule, he dissected her story. He took it apart and destroyed it. Tracy was reduced to standing in the witness box saying, I don't know. I can't remember. And she remembered so many things so clearly. The fat man with staring eyes. But when Krigman was asking her to explain other things, the woolly hat that was found, the timings about why she hadn't gone for help. Tracy was still saying, I don't know, I can't remember. Tracy had given her evidence and it had been destroyed.
Tracy Marguerite Andrews stood impassively in the dock as she was found guilty of the murder of her fiancé.
Marguerite Andrews, the jury has found you guilty on very strong evidence of murder. There is only one sentence prescribed by law, and that is life imprisonment.
We just looked at each other and sighed and sort of, thank God it's over.
She's been found guilty. But I couldn't believe that she told the story she told. And I couldn't believe why she told that story. That's the only thing that baffles me.
For me, there could be no other conclusion that she had stabbed Lee Harvey to death.
Tracy Andrews, the infamous road rage killer, imprisoned for life in 1997, today sensationally confessed that she was responsible for the murder of her fiancé, Lee Harvey. The confession, written from her prison cell, has been attacked by the Harvey family as merely a ploy to reduce her life sentence.
I told Lee to stop the car. I'd rather walk home. I told him it was over and I wanted the keys to be flat.
Tracy, get back in the fucking car.
Pick up, I'm walking.
Christ's sake. Look, I can't leave you out in the middle of nowhere. Get back in the car.
Lots of nasty, nasty things were said. He wouldn't give me the keys, and I told him I'd call the police.
Oh, just piss off and give me the keys! Come on! Get off!
He grabbed me, and I saw he had a knife in his hand.
See if he wants you to mess the place, then, eh?
With that, I need him. I saw the knife on the floor. All I can remember is seeing red. I've never, ever, in my whole life, lost control like I did that night. All I wanted to do was go to sleep and not wake up, turn back time. I wanted Lee to get up and say that he was all right, but I knew nothing was going to happen. I just wanted to die.
Lee, Bob, can you hear me?
That was his knife. He bought three of them back from Spain. He gave one to my youngest son, he gave one to my oldest son, which they've both still got, and they will vouch for that, and he had one. He bought them back from Spain. And he always had that in the side of his car. So it was his knife, it was not anybody else's.
No, there's no evidence at all to support the fact that Lee Harvey had the knife and that she managed to disarm him and then protect herself. She said a lot of things. And every damn thing that she said turned out more or less to be a lie. So why shouldn't a liar keep on lying?
I always thought things would work out. I wanted to marry him. And when we were getting on, it overrode the bad times. They say love is blind. And it is.
She's ruined her own life. She's ruined her daughter's life. She's ruined Lee's daughter's life. She's ruined my life, my husband's and my daughter's life. We've all been affected, all the family.
If you could put a spell on somebody, or you had some kind of a hold on them, she had a hold on him of some kind.
The savage murder of a young woman.
My gut feeling told me she was dead.
And a killer who by law cannot be brought to justice. The story of Julie Hogg, Real Crime, next Tuesday at 9.